This week on My Global Adventure.
Now starts the magic.
It's interesting. That's a good word for it. India's kind of a weird place. You know, there's a bazillion of them back there.
Style today.
If you want to see India and you want to get right into the middle of it, the best way to do it is on an auto rickshaw. We left Sri Lanka, and after a bit of an emotional meltdown in that country, I was pretty much back on track. We arrived in India, and even though I've never been here before, this country has some personal baggage for me.
It just happened to be that the person who treated me worse in this world than anyone was East Indian. And so every time I saw an East Indian person's face in India, I saw him.
Are you married?
I'm not married, no. He was raised East Indian. A lot of times that can be a problem, that mentality can be a problem, because the way that East Indian men view East Indian women, it's different than the way that we're taught to see men and women. It was a very, very difficult time for me, and a time that I'm still trying to repair from. And to go to East India was just like lemon in a paper cut. And I'd always said that I would never allow that event to shape the rest of my life. And I realized that it was.
It's very quiet today. Your version of quiet is a little different than mine.
You go inside?
Oh my gosh, look at the sky. Look at the sky. What's that about?
The gentleman has done his makeup like the Lord Shiva.
Taju is our Indian guide.
Shiva is one of the important gods of Hindu religion.
Yes.
So.
And
he's dressed
it,
up like Lord Shiva.
Is it religious purposes or
for tourist attraction?
Okay. I have to admit, standing next to a live Shiva is a little weird, but I got my picture taken with him anyway.
Over there, there's one more attraction. You would see the man lying down.
Yes.
And then he's just going
levitates
up in the air. And that's the magic. And that's quite interesting to see it.
Sounds worth checking out.
Now starts the magic.
I'm probably one of the most gullible people on the planet, and you know, I can stand there and say, oh yeah, that's a trick, but I don't know how he did it. That was pretty cool. I was impressed.
Isn't it interesting?
It's interesting. That's a good word for it. Pretty interesting. That was different.
This is good India, full of mysticism.
India's kind of a weird place. It's cool, but it's pretty weird. We traveled to Amber, just 12 miles north of Jaipur. If there's one thing India has a lot of, in addition to its 980 million people, it's elephants. This is cool, the elephant loading dock. Do we just hang our legs off the edge?
Yes.
So we do.
You want to sit here?
Yeah.
Okay. And then he's going to turn around.
Oops, sorry.
One more could sit on the side.
Heather, our advanced producer, usually travels a week ahead. So it was nice to have her with us for a few days. We're heading up the hill to the Amber Palace. The road to the fortress can be driven, walked, or traveled the way we did it, the bumpy scenic method.
It's not as uncomfortable as Tim the camel in Morocco, but it's not exactly the most comfortable transportation we have taken.
The
Amber Palace is a majestic fortress. It was built in the year 1216. It sits high up in the mountains and is visited by hundreds of tourists a day. It was spectacular architecture. I mean, the palace itself and the huge wall that surrounded it, really fascinating history that went along with it.
You can see this painting here, and we call it the fresco painting work.
Okay.
So now there is a plan to restore the entire fort complex.
Oh, man, that'll be incredible. I mean, just the way it is right now, it's stunning. Could you imagine if they put it back in its full glory? I thought the Amber Palace was actually really beautiful. Along with a lot of things in India, I'm struck by the ancestry of it. I mean, this country has been around for so long, and it has so much history to it, that to stand in a place like the Amber Palace, you know, it's intense. That's connecting to human past as far as we have it recorded, as far as it's still standing. I needed to just pour out to somebody. I needed somebody to listen to me go, oh my God, I'm losing my mind. I had gotten an email from a friend of mine in Toronto, Michael. He's one of those guys who just always knows the right thing to say at the right time. And I needed to hear it, and I wrote him back. And I sort of half dared him. You know, I know you're an adventurous guy. I dare you to try and put it together and meet us up in Ladakh. And I just sent it.
Here.
He knows my questions before I even ask him. Bet he's a good astronomer.
First you've done it.
Luckily, our next stop took my mind off my heart and on to the stars above.
Hello.
Hello, I'm Asia.
BM Khatri.
Hello, BM. Did they call you BM?
B for Bridge,
yes.
M for Mohan. Khatri, Bridge Mohan Khatri.
Okay,
I'm
excellent.
Right for Astronomical Observatory.
Okay. We arrived at the world's largest observatory in Jaipur. It's called the Jantar Mantar, which translated means instruments for measuring the harmony of the heavens. The Jantar Mantar is home to one of the largest and best preserved sundials in the world. Built in 1728, it's made of marble and brass.
That is a space of 1 hour. Okay. Hour is divided in 4 equal parts.
Yes.
It is quarter hour, 15 minutes. Then this quarter further divided in 3 equal parts. 1, 2, 3. That is for 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. Then 5 equal parts. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1 minute. And finally, that minute is divided by 3 parts. Amazing. Up to 20 seconds.
Wow. So according to this?
According to this, right now, share is there. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 minutes past 3 o'clock. So when we want to know Indian standard time, we have to add 24 minutes more.
Okay.
So right now, share is there nearly 5 minutes past 3 plus 24, mean 29 past 3 o'clock. Now check your watch, please. Should be 3:29.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes. Wow. BM teaches me how to find the North Star, the guiding star for all travelers.
This angle is 27 degrees. Through this line, exactly there, you can see North Pole Star. But from your country, from your place, that angle will differ. Like London, 51 degree above. When you go to Ceylon, just 0 degree. Right on horizon, you can see North Pole Star. So Pole Star, it is guide star.
That's awesome.
Okay? Please.
It's so amazing to me, people who didn't have, you know, the physical understanding of the universe that we have now, that just sort of, you know, made logical and educated guesses on stuff and just kind of sat and looked and thought, okay, well, we need to measure that. I bet you if we put this over here and tilted it this way, I mean, they just figured it out in their heads.
By this, you can identify name of that constellation.
So how would you do that?
I tell you, please come here. Stand here.
He knows my questions before I even ask him. Bet he's a good astronomer.
First we turn it according the location of constellation.
Okay, okay.
Understand?
Yep. BM is passionate about astronomy. He says for him, it's not only the oldest science in the world, but it's one of the only truths.
So when I came here first time in observatory, so I saw It is only monument in India which is very practical. You can't tell a lie here because everything is practical.
Thanks very much for the tour. I envy your position. Hello.
Hi, I'm ready to make you wear your sari now.
Excellent. Well, you don't have to make me wear it. I'm happy to wear it. Now, we're just going to introduce you to everyone that's here. You're Hindu and you own the place that we're staying at tonight.
Whatever you want to keep on your shoulder, you put it separately first, okay? Then you can pleat the rest.
Oh, wow.
Take it around.
You think India, you think certain visual images, and one of them, obviously, is the woman dressed in the sari. So I wanted to do that. I wanted to try it on.
Can you hold it like this?
Yes, certainly. And it was great. It was heavy. And there's a heck of a lot of material involved in it. I didn't realize it was all one big strip of material, all folded up fancy. But it was an experience. Hey, you go to India, you got to give it a try. Oh, look at how traditional I am. Hickory dickory dock, it may not be a clock. They scurry round over feet and on the ground. It may be a terrible shock. Oh, great! Hickory dickory dock, it may not be a clock. They scurry round over feet and on the ground. It may be a terrible shock. The Karni Mata Rat Temple, thousands of brown rats, face your fears early or the altar will be trouble. Oh, great! Once again, we were having a physical adventure that wasn't physical, which was a bummer. But it was the rat temple, which is kind of cool because I had heard about the rat temple before and I'm not bothered by rats, so it wasn't going to creep me out. If it had been like a cockroach temple or something, it just wouldn't have happened. Okay, like it or not, we're at the Karni Mata temple, also known as the rat temple, and we're going to go walk around with some rats. Cows first, please. Hello.
Hello.
Are you Namaste?
Yeah.
You're Bubbles?
Me, Bubbles.
Can you tell me just a little bit about this temple before we get in?
When the priest family member dies, they take birth as a rat. And if a rat passes away, there's a birth in the priest family. So it's a cycle in between the priest family and the rat.
At the vendors next to the temple, we bought our offerings for the rats. How much for it?
15 rupees.
15?
Okay. Yeah.
What all have we got in here?
We got sweet, then scented stick, and a coconut.
Okay, excellent. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. And we just offered to... Armed with our offerings, Bubbles and I enter the Karni Mata temple. We're actually hoping for rats to run across our toes. It's a sign of good luck. We're barefoot.
Yeah.
Can you explain why we go barefoot?
Normally, in all temples here in India, we can't wear shoes. And as there are several rats and people with the bare feet, we don't, even if we step, we don't kill the rat.
So they feel safer if we have bare feet. Upon entering the temple, I get my first glimpse of sleepy rats along the walls.
Oh, look, they're so cute.
This temple is just devoted to rats because they believed that people were reincarnated as rats and hung out there. And they were taken care of. And no, there's a bazillion of them back there. It was weird, and that's the experience that I thought it was going to be. So whether the rats were big or little or sick or healthy or 100 of them or 20 of them, it was still weird. I'm just gonna follow your lead. Look out, little guys. Bubbles suggests I make my offering directly to the rats. Don't be chintzy, they're saying.
feed, feed. And my coconut, can I leave that here?
Yeah.
Oh, there they go. I made my offering. I waited patiently, but no luck. Not even one rat ran over my toes. This is one of those times where my imagination worked in my favor. This man, I had these rats pictured as being this big and everywhere. This is a cakewalk, so to say. Ooh. Just about. We're on our way to Bishnoi village. The Bishnoi people are a 500-year-old sect of the Hindu religion. They live in the desert that surrounds the city of Bikaner, and they are the original environmentalists.
They don't cut trees, they don't kill animals, they don't eat meat, they're purely vegetarian, don't drink. They are the Bishnoi.
The Bishnoi sect was an interesting diversion from what we had experienced so far in India. First of all, they were beautiful people. My goodness, they were very, very good-looking people. They had a lot of sets of rules for living in harmony with nature and harmony with the people around them, and it seemed to be working really well for them.
Now, are they strict about marriage? They keep people... A Vishnu has to marry a Vishnu?
Yeah, that's there.
It is?
Yeah.
Okay.
There are two brothers, and if the eldest passes away and he's married, his wife will go to the younger brother, and she'll be the wife of the younger brother.
Really?
Yeah.
That is all of his property.
Interesting. The Bishnoi people live a peaceful village life. Their homes are made of clay and manure. They make these designs with their fingers when the clay is wet.
They have bread made.
Yeah.
May we sit?
Yeah, there? You can. Good for you.
Okay. And this is curd from their cattle, I assume.
Yes.
You can tell her that this is the best curd we've had in India so far. Tell her it's very good tea. As soon as you're married, you're taken off to your husband's tribe, and you have to fit in with them. And a lifestyle that was 180 degrees from anything I knew.
So how old was she when she got married?
She was 12 years old. Wow. Wow. And how old was she when she was married?
She got married when she was 10. She
came,
when she was 20.
Oh, okay.
But she got married at the age of 10.
Oh, wow.
As we left the village, many women covered their faces when they saw us. It's the custom to do so in front of strangers and respected family members. Thank you. Thank you. Bye, little guy. The train was packed, and we had the good fortune of having a totally insane man come into ours. Bikaner train station on our way back to Delhi. How's everybody feeling this morning? We got a one-way ticket to Delhi.
Nothing in your belly.
Nothing in my belly. Good time to get some reading then. The train from Bikaner to Delhi is an 11-hour ride. We had arranged comfortable first-class seats, but that fell through. That's okay. It's all part of the adventure, as they say, in this adventure world that we're living in. Not bad. Seats are a little hard.
Hard.
Our fan was broken, so it didn't give us any fresh air.
So far, so good.
So far, so good. Exactly.
went into India with so many preconceptions. I went in with a bad experience with an East Indian person. I came out of India with my own experiences. I ended up having good encounters and seeing amazing things. And I also had a chance to really sort of heal, I think, because it was good for me to walk into a culture that had produced something that had hurt me so much in the past and just experience it, you know? And it didn't have to be dramatic. I just experienced it and it helped me move that much further ahead. Small part of me that thought, yeah, actually, if anybody would come and visit me, it would be Michael. But I really didn't think he would do it. I got an email 3 days later, I'm coming to India. I was like, you're insane. I was totally pumped about it, but I couldn't believe he actually did it. I really couldn't believe it. I was, wow. Michael's coming to India, okay.
It was actually a really, really nice ride. To get here to Delhi at last, I don't think I've ever felt more gross in my whole life. But I have someone who flew across the world to come meet me, so I'm gonna go find him first. Actually, it would probably be more to his benefit if I showered first and then went find him. I can't wait!
I'm so impressed with him that he came this far.
Coming up on My Global Adventure.
We encourage Westerners to actually spend a month on a farm